Welcome to the Shake Up Podcast. I'm your host and co-founder of Mr. Consistent, Jared Bell. This is a podcast where we invite friends of the brand into our studio. We get to know their story a little bit better. We chat all things business, culture, and marketing, all while shaking up a few cocktails. This week, we get to know Cat Henesey. Cat is a vibrant individual who has a bunch of wild stories to share with us. Cat talks about being authentically herself and making absolutely no apologies. We also chat about her jewelry label, Henesii, and the two stints she did on The Bachelor. This episode is an absolute belly laugh, so let's get into it. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to The Shake Up. Today, we've got a very special guest, Cat Henesey-Smith. Her handle is @Cat_Henesey. For those playing at home, if you want to jump on, give her a follow after the end of this podcast. Welcome, Cat.
Hello, guys. How are we?
We are good. How are we, Tommy? How are we, Kirsten?
You know, I'm addressing the room. Even though it's just two people speaking.
The mass of thousands behind us. Yes. In the stands.
We got like that button where you like do the claps and the
yeah.
Kat, I know absolutely nothing about you at all. I know you've got a really cool Instagram. Like you've got a brand, you've got a bunch of stuff. But tell us a little bit about you and who you are.
So my name's Kat, obviously. I am 27. I've been living on the coast for almost a year now. And I've been running my brand Henesii for about 3 years.
Yep.
I actually moved over to Bali when I was like 22.
Yep.
So lived there for like 2.5 years, working for a brand over there, doing a bit of buying and designing, and then started off my jewelry label on the side.
Yeah, cool.
Yeah, it was super easy with all the silversmiths and everyone by my doorstep. So
it's kind of fun over there. Like I feel like there's a bit of that going on. Like it's really easy to get things manufactured when you're living there.
Absolutely.
Probably not so easy to get things manufactured when you're living here.
Absolutely not. It's like you finish work and your supplier comes to your house at night. It's the dream.
They bring it around like 10 o'clock at night. They're literally like, I've got my finished piece here. We can go to production, blah, blah.
Literally.
What do you consider yourself like? Because you've got a brand, you've got a loyal following on Instagram. People absolutely love you, but you're also a buyer. Like where do you pigeonhole yourself? Or you just don't?
I don't know. I feel like I'm like, how many like job titles can you give yourself? I mean, I feel like.
I feel like today you can have the list just goes on.
Buyer, designer. Like it's like, you know, I feel like, I mean, like buying is like my main full-time job.
Yep.
Henesii's definitely like stepped back since I've taken on more full-time work. Just for time and everything. It's like so hard to pour into that and like as much as time as I was putting into it before.
Yeah.
So yeah, and then I guess I create content, but I feel like that's never been like my main thing because I've always had a career behind me.
So it's never been a focus. It's just always been more like a hobby, I guess.
Yeah, totally. But it's definitely like growing more, and I'm definitely spending a bit more time doing that side of things now than I was previously.
And your typical day obviously looks fairly different now that you run full-time work. Is it like, how do you split up between work or when you work on Henesii and those kind of things?
So like I'll be at work every day from 8 till 4, and then I'll try and work on my brand at night.
Yep.
But also like I'm very social. I love to go out to dinners. I'm always doing things. So it's really hard to have that self-restraint and allocate that time. So that's kind of like
when
the gist
phone
of it.
Buzzes.
Literally.
The girls are on.
Literally. And my mum's the biggest legend. So she packs all my orders. So she's retired.
Stop it.
So
how
she,
good.
Yeah, she's a legend. Does all that for me and does all the back end things. So I'm pretty much just like, you know, doing the ordering, doing the analysis and stuff. And I've got a girl who runs all my Instagram for Henesii. So
yeah, cool.
I've definitely like stepped back as much as I can.
Yeah. And what do you guys mainly manufacture with Henesii? Like what's your key core lines?
It's all gold jewelry.
Yeah.
So, but it, originally it was, sterling silver with gold plating, but I've kind of stepped to like, steel based with gold plating just cause the quality of the gold lasts longer with this special machinery they can use.
Yeah, okay.
So, yeah, it's all gold, rings, necklaces, earrings. So, yeah, just an array of any type of jewellery you can get your hands on.
Absolutely. Like, obviously, your life has changed a little bit since the whole COVID shenanigans. Have you always been from the Gold Coast?
No, I'm originally from Brisbane.
Okay.
So I was.
Oh, yeah, I remember. We discussed that off air. You used to date a friend of mine.
Yeah, literally. Literally. So funny. Small from world. From Brisbane. Yeah, from Brisbane. So grew up there and then moved overseas at like 22, then back to Brisbane. And I was buying for another company for a few years and then made the move down here last year. So.
Welcome.
Wouldn't have it any other way.
How good is it?
Oh my God, it is so good. The vibe down here is so different. Everyone's so fun and lovely, and it's just it's way more relaxed.
Everyone just wants to be at the beach and hanging out and having good times, drinking cocktails in the sun.
Drinking Mr. Consistent. Plug.
Drinking cocktails in the sun. It's the bloody best. But whereabouts on the coast do you live?
So I'm in Mermaid.
Mermaid?
So I think I'll always stick around Mermaid to Burley. Yeah, I'm literally 200 metres from all the bars in Nobby's. So I can just waltz on down and it's the best.
Run, oh, how good. Run a mark down in Nobby's.
Yeah, literally.
How good.
Try not to, but.
When the phone buzzes, as I said. Mm-hmm. Anyway, we're going to drink these cocktails, but we're going to get you to do the speed test and see if you can get in the top three. Because you're not going to beat the reigning champ.
Reigning champ happens to be Jared. 22:54. Top three to make it in is 30 seconds and 29.
Make a cocktail.
Make a cocktail.
So how intense are we talking? Like, am I pouring it in a shot glass? Am I shaking it? Like,
there's measurements. I'll walk you through it.
Okay.
But the person who is in third place double scooped ice.
Oh,
so they double scooped ice. So, they double scooped ice. So it took like an extra 1 or 2 seconds off their time instead of just scooping once. And right, dumping
so
in.
They so don't worry about being neat.
It's not about being neat. So get it done.
Right. Well, you're definitely giving me some tips to potentially beat you now. So
please do, because it would be the best.
Yeah. Everyone comes in and I'm like, I'm the champ. I'm the champ. The champ is here.
Not for long.
Hopefully. Anyway, someone needs to beat me, so hopefully it's you. All right, let's get it on. Kat, we're going to go on 3, 2, 1, go.
Yeah.
75 mils of mix.
Yeah.
45 mils of booze. Ice. 5 shakes, dried lime. We'll go 3, 2, 1, go. How you feeling? You're not really shaking, so I'm scared here. You could be on here.
Please right. Win.
3, 2, 1, go.
Jesus.
That was a bit of a false start.
He's worried.
45 mils. There we go. Boom. Ice.
Good.
There we go.
Yeah, it's good.
There we go. Chuck, glass on top. 5 shakes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now you got to crack it
don't
open.
Don't worry about it. Keep going.
Don't worry about it. Take the top off. Take the top off. Crack it.
Oh, no.
There we go.
The victim.
Put the strainer on. No. Put the strainer on. Oh.
Yeah, good.
Now dried fruit. Oh, my goodness gracious me. 29.76.
Oh, okay. Oh, I didn't know that. Hey, the lid. Hey, that's top three though.
What did we get? We've completed the speed test. You've gone to third place.
We had a few screw up moments there that really could have gotten me to the top.
There were some defining moments in your loss.
Literally. I dropped the ice, got the glass stuck when I needed to get it out from shaking it, and it was downhill from there. But
29.76, respectable.
Yeah.
Absolutely respectable. Quicker than most bars. How good. Kat, you started off as, like you said, you started off as a fashion buyer. How does one get into fashion buying?
So I started off in the retail industry super young, so probably from about 16, working in stores. And then I started working at Dish when I was, oh God, probably like 16, 17. Yep. And then I started doing work in their warehouse and then started like doing little admin jobs for the buyers and stuff. And I used to do like a lot of fit modeling when I was a size 6. But
me too.
Yeah. Those were the days. So I'd go to like showings of them and brands and stuff and kind of just like got exposed to all of it. And then I got my first buying role at 19 just as an assistant buyer.
Yep.
So I worked for City Beach for like 3 years.
Damn, we probably DJed the Christmas
Man, that's exactly where that is it.
We used to DJ all that. Me and Tom used to DJ all their Christmas parties.
Yeah.
At the Normanby.
I can't. I was like, I'm never coming back here.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, so I feel like there would have been multiple occasions, but yeah. But yeah, so I started off there and worked there for a few years, ended up like going to buyer and getting like a few of my own categories and stuff.
Yep.
So obviously for people who don't know, when you buy for a brand, you'll look after certain areas of like clothing. So,
accessories or, yeah, or tops dresses. And bottoms and dresses. Yep.
And then I kind of went through a bit of a shitty stage when I was like 22, got like really bad anxiety and really stressed and like just wasn't in a good headspace. So my parents, the legends, they were just like, look, you're too young. Like you need to just quit your job and you should just
City
go traveling.
It's a great place to work, but when you're that young and you're driven and you get dropped in it really quickly,
heavily. It was a lot, but it's definitely like, shaped me for where I am now, totally. Like I learned so much there, so it was awesome. But very intense like time, like having a proper full-time job.
So it turns into a career really quick versus being like, oh, I'm a teenager, I'm having fun. I'm like, you know, when teenagers go on gap years and all that kind
of
shit.
And I didn't do that. So so then I quit my job and I booked a one-way trip to Europe and just went traveling by myself for 6 months and it was the best thing I ever did. And then I ended up applying for this job in Bali and flew home, came back for, you know, a month or so and then flew over and started a new role over there. And it was just the best decision I could have ever made. I met so many cool people. The lifestyle was so different, so much more relaxed.
So cool over there.
It was epic. So that's, I guess, I was started off there, then went to another buying role there. And I think I just like learnt so much being over there in terms of like, you know, learning another language, seeing supplies every day, you know, you're really in the thick of it in a different set of ways.
It's not easy to get a job there, or have sponsorship or whatever it is.
Yeah.
I've done some stuff with Commune and they've obviously got Commune in Bali and very similar situation.
Oh, are they the same?
Yeah, same owners.
I did not know that. Yeah. I was just like, oh, there's one in the curls.
Because they're way different. Like one's party vibes and like he's obviously not. The one in Coolangatta now is not so much party vibes.
Yeah.
The one in Bali is very resorty, sit around the pool, drink cocktails, surf, but like fitness orientated. They've got gyms, yoga, all that kind of stuff. But then the one here is just like dance on a fucking table and go,
literally. Drink hard. I did not even realize they were linked.
Yeah,
that's
they're linked. But it's not easy to get a sponsorship role.
Yeah.
We sponsored over there.
Yeah, you had a visa and everything, which was awesome. It was just like, you know, you can come in and out whenever you want.
Yeah.
Whereas like, half my mates over there were doing like visa runs every few months and that's just a mission. So, I probably left enough to come home to visit everyone that I probably could have done that. But it was legit. And so did that. And then that is when I was over there and I applied for the Bachelor. Just as like a laugh. I was like, why not? Like, let's, you know, what could happen kind of thing.
Yeah.
And I like did this audition video and then I ended up, they called me up. They really want to meet you, like come to Australia. So I flew in.
Visa run.
Yeah, visa run, literally. Flew in, had like a group audition, got to the next round, then had like a meeting with like all of the head producers and stuff. Yep. And then a week later they called me. They were like, hey, like we want you on the show. Can you start filming this date? So I literally had a few days to pack up my apartment because if I had made it to the end of the show, which I definitely didn't, did not connect with the honey badger.
The season you're
that
on?
That was the one I was on.
We did not
get along. Actually, no. I just think he was not in the right headspace there.
I did a quick Google search. Like, I'll be honest, I did a quick Google search this morning and it was like, cat calls out honey badger reacts. I was like, oh, how good is this?
Yeah, literally.
I know nothing about the Bachelor.
I called him a prawn and they were like, cat calls the honey badger a prawn. I'm like, well, I mean, he does have a really good rig and like average face. So like, can you blame me? But like,
speak your truth.
Yeah, literally. I'm like, I'm just fucking saying it how it is, which is what gets me in trouble most of the time. Anyway, so.
Did you have your brand before you started?
Yeah, so I had it on the show and that was like a whole, obviously, you know,
was that like a deciding factor? It was like, oh, there's an opportunity of PR
my brand
here.
Or, blew up after it for it. Sure. So it was like, you can't pay for that sort of marketing. I had like, I remember the pair of earrings I wore on the first episode sold out overnight. Like it was just nuts. But it also like caused a lot of negative kind of response to my brand as well, just because I was cast as the villain.
Yeah, well, it's always going to happen, right?
Like totally.
You go into those shows. I have never watched Bachelor, but I've watched a show on Netflix where they talk about, they show the behind the scenes.
Unreal.
Of the Yeah.
That's legit it. That is, if anyone has watched The Bachelor who is listening and who has seen Unreal, I swear on my life that that is what it is. There's literally like the limousine that you come in on. You're like, oh my God, amazing. They've been like picked up in this limo. No, no. It's literally you
get in one side,
there.
Get out the other.
No, you get taken there in a fucking minivan with like garbage bags on the thing so that paparazzis don't get you. You're getting your hair and makeup done in like a like an RSL pub. I didn't meet him until 3 a.m. on the red carpet, and it's literally a limousine going in the driveway. Like
so
it was
good.
Fucked. I was like, you're kidding.
I watched that. I watched Unreal, and I was like, it's on, I think it's on Netflix or something like that. But like I watched it and I was like, there's no way this is true. And Chris was like, oh, maybe it, my wife, she's like, maybe it is. And I'm like, now that you say that, like, fuck, that is wild. Cause the shit that happens on that show.
Yeah. It's fucked.
That's loose.
I'd get like threatened. Like if you don't do this, then like we're going to send you home. Or like in the first episode, there was like a girl.
Do you have like NDAs and shit where like you're not meant to
you
say
have to
this
sign,
shit? I was like,
oh
was like
yeah, a, but like. Fuck them.
Whatever.
Yeah, whatever. I just feel like they fucked me so hard that I'm just like, come at me. Yeah, no,
whatever,
just kidding.
Whatever,
but,
bruv.
but pretty much like on the, I feel like I've completely sidetracked from this buying thing. Like I've gone, I'm like, and then this happened. But I feel like that's
you've
what
gone
podcasts
back there.
Are
you've
for.
Gone back there now anyway. Like that's where you've ended up in your career
yeah,
now.
Yeah, totally. But yeah, like even, what was like, I forgot what I was going to tell you just then. Yeah, so like on the first episode, there was a girl on the show who had just been sleeping with my ex-boyfriend a few weeks before.
Oh my God.
And the producers literally like forced me to bring it up on camera with her, and they use like little kind of tools. They're like, well, if you don't bring it up, it's going to come out and then you're going to look like you're desperate. You're going to look like you're obsessed with him. Like you're going to look like you're not over your ex, and Australia is going to think that.
Do you reckon like, these people like have psych majors or something in here?
Like, yeah, they like work you all to a fucking T. And so then I'm like, oh, okay, I'll bring it up, but I'll do it in a nice way. Oh, no, they cut this angle here and there and make me look like a fucking devil. And then first episode, boom, hated. So it's like.
The earring sold out, but.
Yeah, but, you know, rich bitch. No, just kidding. But, yeah, and then the other thing that was really difficult for me was because I'm a really strong personality, I'm a strong woman, all the girls, I feel like they maybe, I feel like when you say people are threatened by that, you sound like a dick, but I felt like they didn't love that about me. So then they went on camera and were like, Kat's only here to promote her jewellery label. Like, she's not here for love. And I'm like, well, you know what? It's fucking 2018. If you're on here only to meet find love, you're full of it. Like, everyone is here with an agenda, whether you want an Instagram following, whether you have a startup business. Like, every single one of those girls.
I think that's reality TV in general.
100%. And they all, like, pigeonholed me and, like, shamed me for being a strong businesswoman as opposed to being, like, that's really cool that you do your own thing. So it was like I was cornered. So Cat from Bali promoting her shit jewelry line. Like it was like it was fucked. I even had to turn like my reviews off on my website because strangers are writing like fake reviews. I was getting like death threats. Like it was.
Who ran the business for you while you were in there? Like who did all that for you?
So I have like a girl over in Bali who would work for me. So she'd like do all because she's Indonesian. So she'd go and speak to my suppliers. I'm stocked in a bunch of stores over there. So she'd like restock and then, yeah, she shipped out all my orders for me. I just paid her to do all of that. So, yeah, it just kind of ran in the background.
How good.
Yeah. So, and then I think I like scheduled, that's a lie. I asked one of my really good girlfriends who's a social media girl to post for me while I was in there and the legend did it.
That's it.
I know.
I feel like your parents sent you away to relieve the stress and anxiety.
I know.
And you chucked yourself in the deep end and got a whole heap deeper in it.
Oh, I know, right. No, but the thing is when I had really, when I was like suffering really badly with anxiety, I used to, this was my favorite show and I was like, fuck, I wish I could do this. Like I looked at these women in awe to have that confidence and like put themselves in these crazy situations. And then when I like went overseas and did that whole stint, I was like, you know what? I could do this. So it was a really big step and like a reward for myself how far I'd come.
Yep.
If that makes sense. So
absolutely.
Anyway.
And then how did you start the label? Like were you just like, oh, I'm sick of this buying thing or you're working over there for another brand. You're just sick of that stuff. And you're like, did you stay working and then start developing the brand, or you just went cold turkey, I'm going to start Henesii and this is what I'm going to make, this is what I'm manufacture and build my website and away I go? Or
My boss over there, I'm still my old boss, still really close with her. She's the biggest legend. So I was working 4 days a week for her. So yep. That's what you'd do with Westerners coming over there to work for her. They just do 4 day weeks.
Yep.
So dreamy. I do literally.
Oh my
vibe.
God.
I know. I was like, how could I ever work full time again?
Brand new. People start asking
for I know, literally. Here. Hey, can I like have Friday off? But yeah, so I worked for her 4 days a week, and I've always like dreamed of having my own label. So I just kind of sat down with her and I was like, hey, look, like how would you feel about me starting up a jewelry label? Like it'd be, you know, quite much more premium pricing than like what we're selling here. Yep. Like it'd be really different. And she was awesome and was fully supportive of me doing it, which is quite rare. So
there's a pretty cool like expat community over there as well. Like everyone's got shit going on. Everyone's starting brands. Everyone's got
sick
cafe shops, all that kind of stuff.
Well, it was so easy to run it living over there because I was surrounded by a bunch of creatives who were pretty much freelancing over there. Yeah. So it's like I also do a bit of styling work. So I used to like style for an agency over there. I don't do this anymore. But so I'd like collab with photographers, do styling, and then I'd also like put my jewelry in the shoots too. So I'd always have like fresh imagery and stuff, and then like people would want to borrow stuff for shoots. So it was really collaborative over there and made it really easy to like.
Where were you based out of?
So first I was in Canggu.
Yeah. That's like the spot,
Canggu,
right?
Like Brawa.
That's the spot.
It's awesome. And then I moved to Umalas. So Umalas is like in between Seminyak and Canggu.
Yep.
And it's like more rice paddy fields, a bit more chilled.
Yeah.
And it was close to my work because I was like, literally, I used to drive past the Korobakan prison every day. I'd be like,
hey, Chappelle.
I literally worked What's by up? The jail. I was like, Chappelle Corby, love you. Have you heard her song she brought out?
Yeah.
Did you hear that? It's like, she brought out a if anyone knows Chappelle Corby, I don't know how we're even going here right now, but she brought out a song called
I think
Palm
everybody
Trees.
Everybody knows Chappelle
Yeah, and
Corby.
It was like, Palm Trees on the Gold Coast, so pretty. And like, it was like, I honestly, I think I played it to someone at work like a month ago. I was like, hey, have you heard Palm Trees by Chappelle Corby? They were like, no. I was like, Palm Trees so pretty. Like, so bad. Anyway, so yeah, I used to drive past that prison every day and it was eerie as fuck.
What was the inspiration for Henesii then?
As in what was the inspiration for me to start the brand?
That and the pieces.
Yeah, I feel like when I started, it was kind of just as that gold jewelry trend was happening.
Yeah, another one, yeah.
There was like no, it was like you either go to La Visa or spend $500 on a necklace. So there was no like middle range and like really cool detailed pieces that you can layer and stuff. And there was that whole kind of like religious trend coming in and like zodiacs and stuff. Yep. Like I was like the first one to do zodiac necklaces.
You're
and
right.
Then everyone pumped them.
Started
so I did, I brought out a zodiac necklace like 4 years ago or three, whenever the hell I started. And yeah, now everyone's got them. So yeah, I think it was just like statement jewelry that you can wear that's not going to like tarnish. And
how do you design them all? Like what's the process in designing the
pieces?
So
my first range, I actually like when I was in Europe, I went around to a bunch of like flea markets and stuff.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
I collected all of these like vintage charms and like reworked them with my supplier to like upcycle all of them.
Yep.
So I'd use like all recycled silver and get them to kind of update them and stuff. Yeah. So that was a big part of it. Then there was a whole like bug trend. Lol, feels so weird now saying it. But like bees were really cool.
Yeah,
and, like,
I remember,
so
I
brought out these like bee earrings, these big cicada earrings. The cicada earrings are the one I wore on the first night of Bachelor and they just went psycho. Like I just
Do you still make them now?
I've just stopped selling them, but they're still selling. Like they were my best seller for so long. And the bee earrings, like I couldn't get enough of them.
That's so cool. And,
yeah.
And then how often do you launch new pieces? Do you like it in collections or are you doing just whenever you feel like you need to add a couple of pieces, you put a couple of pieces in, take a couple out? Like
yeah, I'll do like a collection. I'll do like a big photo shoot around it. So I think like my last one, I probably just like added 20 new pieces and I've just ordered a bunch of new stuff that I need to shoot and like we'll get that up online and stuff. Yep. So I used to do like monthly little shoots, but I just am so time poor right now. It's really hard to do that. So I think just like getting it out to influencers and getting imagery that way as well is a massive help.
Content is such a powerful
tool. Totally. So,
especially if you've got something people want, right? Like, absolutely. You're giving people value or something they actually want to wear on the weekends and stuff like that.
That's a thing. And I feel like if you're contacting something that someone doesn't want to promote, then that's when you're always going to have to like fork out a bit of coin around it, because do I really want to promote tampons on my Instagram? Not really. So, like, you know, but do I want to get a necklace that I'd wear and probably pay for myself for free and do a story? Shit, yeah.
The funniest one I've seen is a cleaning company.
Oh, Co cleaning. Yeah. Everyone does it. I'm like, do I buy this? I'm like, sold.
Oh, like, I'm like,
I think it's really good.
Yeah.
I've heard really good things. I'm like, co cleaning, do I buy the mop? Like, you know, it's like, you know, you're getting old and you're like getting excited about cleaning products, or like me asking mum for a saucepan for Christmas. I was like, ooh.
What's the difference in now, like you're now running a label from Australia versus running it in Bali? You still manufacture everything over in Bali?
So I shifted in COVID. So because of like obviously everything happening in COVID, all the silver prices went like through the roof.
Yeah.
So it literally, I couldn't justify the cost prices and getting it made over there anymore. Yep. Like a necklace went up to like $60 cost price. Whoa. And like, it was just fucked. So I've now moved it to China, which means there's not as much of like free will designing as much as I would have done before, just because I guess.
Bali's still like really handcrafted, really hands on, where trying to start to become a little bit more machine manufactured, and all those kind of things.
Totally. But in terms of like the gold quality, I'm like way happier with China. Just they're like a lot more onto it and have way more updated machinery.
Absolutely.
And it's a lot cheaper than Bali.
Yeah.
So it was definitely like the right move for me. But like I miss kind of going over there and doing like big days of designing and like driving to weird little bead shops and like it was a lot of fun.
Finding materials over there. Totally, being involved in the manufacturing process.
Yeah, which is what I'm so creative. That's, you know, what I love and what I love to do. So,
hopefully when this COVID shit ends.
Yeah, I know.
What's your vibe on that? What's your vibe on
COVID? Yeah. I'm just like, get me to a fucking tropical island. I like want to go and
Desperate to go back to Hawaii. Yeah. That's my spot.
I was like messaging this hot guy that I used to bang in Bali the other day. And I was like, can we just like go to like the Philippines together or something? He's like, come over. I'm like, fucking, I would.
Pay for my vaccine and my very expensive flight.
Yeah, literally.
And then my hotel quarantine on the way back.
Vibe. Worth it for like three routes.
Like, you must be good.
No, I mean, like, yeah, but.
Yeah, but yeah.
Well, I'm single, so.
What's your advice for somebody wanting to start their own label, their own business, their own small manufacturing, making products?
I would just like find something you're really passionate about, find a point of difference, because you like with the way Instagram is and AliExpress and all of those like, you know, platforms that people can start a business so easily, the market is so saturated. So it's like, if you spot something, get onto it then and there. Like, you know, those candles, for instance, of the torso of the female body. Like,
The twirly candle, like the bent candles.
Yeah, all of those.
So cool.
And it's like, you know, when they came out, like I know a few brands jumped on them and they've all blown up. It's just like maybe like three brands that have done so well out of it. But it's like, don't make it too hard. Make the range small and concise. Like, promote it really well. Start a TikTok. I know that so many small brands have like blown up off TikTok.
Yeah.
I think just give it a go. Like, what's it going to be? And like, even though you might go, oh, I don't want to buy 200 units of this. It's like, well, it might only be like $500 or
invest in something. If you believe in it, invest in it, right?
Totally. I feel like it's important to give everything a go. And that's the thing, is it's like, yes, Henesii might not be a forever thing for me. Like, I might, you know, start a different brand, or like I might venture out of that. Like, I don't know what the next 5 years are going to entail, but like that was always my dream and that was a goal of mine and I've done it. And that's like, you don't want to look back on things and regret anything.
Yeah. Any pinch me moments with Henesii? Like, oh, this person, like Kat from The Bachelor, is wearing Henesii. Right? Has there been any like pinch me moments
I've had a lot of really phenomenal girls wear it. I think a pinch me moment, I went over and styled Mammy Swim Week and I had the entire runway styled in Henesii. And they were all like the biggest US models in it over there. I've had some like really, really big influencers and stuff wear it. So I think that would probably be the most, like, definitely, like, Miami Swim Week was super fun.
That is cool. I always wanted it. I used to own a shop in James Street, like, and swimwear was one of our main things.
Yeah.
And we always wanted to go to Miami Swim Week because it just looks
It was sick. So fun. It was so good.
Like a party, beautiful people everywhere.
Yeah, it was epic. So that was definitely – oh, and I think another highlight, I shot my, like, second campaign in LA. So I don't know how I managed to get this together, but I jumped on this page called, like, LA Photographers and Models and blah, 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 blah. And I, like, posted this thing, and then I literally went complete stalker mode on Instagram. I found these three models that were, like, beautiful. I got three models to come to a house in LA and model for me for free. I managed to get the brand Motel to send me their entire collection to style them in.
Stop.
And hired this house that was kind of like an Airbnb photo shoot house over there.
Yep.
And I hired that and, like, pretty much got all of this thing together for, like, under $500. And
that's the campaign, true hustle.
Yeah, the campaign was, like, it was so sick. So I was so happy. I'll show you the video after of, like, yeah, it was just – that was, like, a really, like, cool moment, you know? Yeah. And it's, like, it's so easy to do things and people – like, you've just got to really hustle and, like, give it your all.
You do not get.
Yeah, and I'll probably ask things that are probably a bit inappropriate sometimes, but, you know, exactly, don't ask, don't get.
Yeah, exactly. Like, that's my number one rule. Like, when you're asking for things, you don't – like, literally, if you don't ask, you will not receive. And that, like, finding where the boundaries are in business, finding where the boundaries are in your relationships with people and all those kind of things. And people are there. People want to help.
Yeah, 100%. And it's like, you know, small startup business, like, you're not going to get those big influencers being like, here, $3,000 for this post. Like, you know, people want to help you out and people, like.
If they're asking for $3,000, they don't want
to
help.
No, that's what I mean. Yeah. Like, they're not going to do that to a startup, whereas they might to, like, Meyer or, you know, like, I don't know. That was a bad example. But
absolutely. All right. Well, we're going to go take a little break and then we'll be back.
Love it.
This episode is sponsored by our production team. They're working around the clock using the freshest ingredients to make our delicious cocktail mixes for you guys to enjoy. Now back to the episode.
We've talked about The Bachelor a little bit. You obviously, the first time you went on there, you hated it. Why'd you go on Bachelor in Paradise? Like, seriously, like, that's a legitimate, like.
Well, I was just like, it can't get any worse. Like, what else are they going to do to me? Like, what are the, you know, how much worse can it get? My edit can only get better. And they were flying me to Fiji and paying me awesome coin to drink cocktails with a bunch of dudes. Like,
I'm on,
literally. So I'm like, why not? So I think that was definitely got me on there.
Was it as production scale as, like, the one in Australia?
Nah, it was, I feel like it was way more chilled because you're actually getting to spend quality time with the dudes in there. Whereas, like, you see the Bachelor, like, I don't know, once.
It was like eight girls, eight guys. Right, in, like, Bachelor in Paradise or whatever
it is?
Yeah,
they bring in, like, I think started off it was, like, eight or nine dudes, eight or nine girls, and then they keep bringing people in so the number gets uneven. So then they do a rose ceremony and then, like, people are going home.
A little bit.
Yeah, so they kind of just kept dripping people in every few days.
How'd you go on that one?
Awful. Like, it was so shit. I mean, a lot of the guys, I feel like,
were you on the one with the guy that, like, walked in naked, or was it?
Yeah. Oh, no, I wasn't. I was like, yes.
That's
but
the only
no.
thing I remember of that guy, because he's like, he goes and does like nude paintings and stuff.
Yeah, so random. Yeah, no, I was not on that one. I was on the one before. And I think I just jumped into it way too soon. So, like, I filmed when it went to air and then it finished and 2 weeks later I flew to Fiji and went straight back into filming. So my whole 2018 was pretty much Bachelor.
Yeah, right.
And then I had to live through it through 2019 as well because it didn't air until, like, April, and then it's like, you know, you're doing all your press and, like, it's just, it kind of just carried on. And I guess, like, any guy that goes on The Bachelor, it's like, hey, how are ya?
Handpicked.
Probably not the biggest legend. So I think a lot of those guys on there, like, they're kind of want a bit of clout and they're just kind of, I don't know.
Yeah.
Anyway, weren't my cup of tea, but I felt like they only wanted the girls that got a really good edit. So yeah, right. I was like, stay away from that bitch.
And how I was do you like, know who's getting a good edit though? Like behind the scenes, like is it they're giving this person heaps of airtime, they're giving this person heaps of airtime, they're showing this person love or whatever it is? Like,
I think like you'd know by like dates.
Yeah.
But then like I was interviewed and mic'd the most out of anyone.
Yeah. Okay.
And that's because they knew I was always going to speak. I'd always say something controversial or like I would always, whereas other girls would sit there and they'd be mic'd and they'd just be like, it'd literally be like fucking silence.
Fucking snore factory.
Literally. And it's like as soon as the cameras would go off, everyone would be like, nah, 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 nah. But yeah, everyone was so like worried about getting a bad edit that they just weren't themselves or yeah, I was right. just myself on and off camera. But anyway, so yeah, so I went on Bachelor in Paradise, did not meet anyone. And then I was in the rose ceremony and I was like, I'm not going to get a fucking rose. And I just walked out. I was like, fuck this. And like stormed out of the rose ceremony, but they were fucked. Like they honestly, like I think it was like, it kind of all came to a bit of a head when I was filming that and it's like I didn't really deal with everything I'd been through from Bachelor and I pretty much had like a mental breakdown. Like it was fucked. I was like, holy shit, I've just been getting like death threats for 6 months. Like I'd say something on an episode and within 2 minutes I'd have 900 abusive comments on my photo all like,
do you still have your
yourself.
Phone at that point? Like are you still go on your phone no, or no, they
this
take
is when
their
it
phone?
Aired. You've yeah, no phone, right, you have yeah, no gotcha. Connection to the outside world, no news. You get to call your parents once every 2 weeks for 15 minutes on a monitored call and they can't ask you anything. You're like, how was your dinner? What did you do today? It's like, you know, so it's, that was fucked. But yeah, so I just had a bit of a breakdown walking out of the episode. I was like, this is just all too much. Like this is fucked.
You can't just get on a plane, right? They can't just like leave nah. and get on
so
a plane.
So then they locked me in a hotel room. They wouldn't let me call my parents. They wouldn't give me my phone. I was like crying. I was like, this is fucked. Like just let me speak to my mum and dad. Like what am I going to do? Yeah, it was literally torture. So they locked me in this hotel room for like 15 to 17 hours. And then whoa. I got taken in
like
this
hostage.
Yeah, literally I got taken in this weird little cab to the airport. And then when I got to like the gates to walk through, then they were like, here's your phone. I was like, fuck you guys, honestly. And
that's
yeah,
horrible. That's a horrible experience.
It was horrific. So I was like, yeah, I mean, no regrets because I'm going to look back at this shit when I'm 40 and be like, fucking my 20s are wild. So, you know, I don't regret anything. Probably could have done things better or whatever, but, you know, you live and you learn.
Absolutely. Yeah. I couldn't, I've had family that have been in real life hostage situations.
Yeah.
That sounds just as bad. Like it sounds horrible.
It was fucked. So.
Advice for anyone who wants to apply.
Oh, I feel like everyone who applies thinks that they're like a catch and thinks they're going to be the one at the end. But at the end of the day, you don't know how Australia is going to perceive you. You don't know how they're going to cut or edit you. You could be the stage 5 clinger, even though you might be the nicest girl, or you could be the fucking bitch, even though you're just like outgoing. So,
what if it's an ulterior motive? Like if it is to get some clout or get some Instagram, like you want to grow your Instagram fault, like you got to make a choice, right?
Yeah, I'd probably go don't go on The Bachelor because I feel like no one gets followers from that anymore. Like some of the chicks from last season are sitting on 5K. I'm like,
do they still hold you? Like when you're on there, they post and stuff for you during the season or like they?
Yeah,
they
you have to like give someone your password and they have to post every fortnight or something.
Wow.
Yeah, it's fucked. But yeah, I don't know. I probably wouldn't recommend it to anyone. Just I think you've got to be like really mentally strong to do something like that. And if you were going on it for clout, I'd go on like Maths or like Love Island or something because I feel like those people blow up. Like The Bachelor's changed heaps and it's not what it used to be.
Yeah, true.
Yeah. Not that you've ever watched it, but
honestly, like
tune in.
Yeah. I haven't had TV for a long time, but
which
like,
is great.
Yeah, I just never got into it. Like the reality TV, I used to love watching some reality TV.
Yeah.
But then when that shit started coming out, I was like, half of this shit is like, it's so scripted or it feels fucked. So like fake or they're just throwing people under the bus constantly. Yeah. It doesn't like some people get off and watching that like, oh, this is going to happen or literally. Whatever. So I'm like, oh, this feels awkward. I can't watch. I literally can't watch.
Literally.
Yeah. I can't keep watching.
You just never know where it's going to take you. Like, Brooke Blurton, she was in my season. She is the biggest legend and she just got announced as the Bachelorette today.
Yeah.
So her she would have gotten a shit ton of coin for that. She's probably going to meet a really great guy. Yeah. And, you know, so it can go either way. Even like Abby Chatfield.
Like that Tim and Anna yeah, or whatever,
like
wasn't there?
Like, kids. Yeah. And same with like Maddie J and Laura. Like, you don't know where it's going to take you. So I think like it's hard taking advice from me because I had such a negative experience with it. But I think you've just got to go into it being open to the fact that anything could happen. Literally. And if you're okay with potentially getting death threats, then fucking sign up.
Sign your life away.
Yeah, literally.
Prepared to get locked in a room for 14 hours.
Oh, it's so much waiting around. It's fucked.
How long's the filming go for, like day to day? Like, is it like you film for like 7 hours a day, you film 14 hours a day, and then you do whatever the fuck you want after that? Or is it?
Nah, so like a single date will literally be filmed for like 16 hours. Woo-hoo. And like a group date, well, you'd
get paid by the hour, or you get paid by the day,
or you get paid by like the week or something.
Wow.
So then, like when you're on a group date, you'd probably get picked up at like 6 a.m. in the morning, and then you wouldn't get back until like 7 at night. Because it's so much like they've got to do different scenes, and they do these things called like voxies is what they call them, where you get pulled away for like individual interviews on sets. Yeah, and then you're sitting in a room and you're waiting for everyone to do their interview. And like, so it's a lot of waiting around.
Boring.
Yeah, fucking boring snore.
Batshit. You don't have your phone on Instagram to be swiping.
Nothing.
You on the Tiki? On the TikTok?
Am I on the TikTok? Yeah. Fucking oath, I love it.
Yeah?
Yeah, like I'm obsessed.
It's a wormhole, eh?
It is the big, I'm like, probably really addicted to it.
How's it? Because you've got obviously a heap of Instagram followers. What's a Tiki like?
Honestly, I should be fucking TikTok famous right now. I'm like sitting at fucking 300 followers. You're
like cute little dancers and stuff like that. What are you doing? Like,
I'll show you after, but I'm doing all this weird shit and I thought it would be like, like they're fucking funny and I'm really fucking not happening. I've had like two videos blow up, but I'm still at 300 followers.
It's so like, it feels like it's all just millennials just doing cute dances in front of it to like popular songs.
I mean,
songs,
I don't know what's in your feed, but.
No, but like when you go up, like in that For You page, you're like,
totally. It's definitely a younger generation.
You're either doing dances or your hacks.
Yeah, yeah.
They're the people popping off.
Totally.
Or I did that. What's the picnic blanket one? And your wife's wearing it. Like I did film one the other day.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. When like they're wearing like a chair.
The New Zealand guy.
Yeah,
like,
I know that one.
That shit's popping off.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I like that kind of stuff.
That one's epic. Yeah, no, it's definitely a younger generation, but I do think it's like been really positive for social media. I think that it's like taken away that stamina of like having to be perfect and like having this picture perfect, amazing life. Whereas it's
not a highlight reel like Instagram always has been.
Totally. And like now people are being so raw, they're posting pretty fucked up shit. But it's like you can actually relate to some of it and it's things you would have never seen on the internet before. So I personally think it's been a really great move for
social stuff.
Yeah, hey, totally.
It's really cool. And that, so many like brands are jumping on board. Yeah. Like, yeah, it's really cool.
Yeah, it's great.
I want to talk about like you're huge on self-love.
Yeah.
Dating. Like you just told me you went down to Sydney for a weekend just for a rendezvous. What's your daily routines for self-love? How do you start your day? How do you end your day? Like what's the key parts to keeping sane happy?
I mean, I always surround myself with people that really lift me up and, you know, give me a lot of like positive vibes and everything.
Yeah.
I love my job. I love what I do. I love being by the beach. So like obviously, you know, meditating, exercising, all of those little things are super important. But
we're talking like Wim Hof method here, or are we talking just like sitting on the beach just
meditating?
Yeah.
Oh no, I'd like do a nighttime meditation before bed, or like maybe one in the morning or something. And like definitely I've joined this boot camp called Peachy Fit, and it's like on the Esplanade in Burley, and it's all women, it's super supportive, so I'm loving doing that. That's what my challenge is. I'm gonna go on strong, clearly. But
vapes and cocktails,
literally. Vapes and cocktails, don't tell anyone. But I mean, self-love, I just feel like I've always been like a very confident and like sure of myself person, so I just think it's like remembering those things. And in terms of dating, like I don't know, I just really get myself out there. I feel like you can never say no. I definitely have all the apps and stuff. I've been super lazy lately.
We're talking like Tinder, Bumble,
Hinge, Bumble, got them all. But like, I mean, I rarely get on there and swipe. It's just a fucking mission. I actually have a date this Saturday. So that's
shout out to the date.
Yeah, shout out to the date, literally. Love it. I put up a question box and he replied to it going, how do I make a good first impression? I was like,
stop it.
Smooth, I'm going to write that down.
Yeah.
Question box.
Literally, I loved that. I was like, fucking here for that.
What is it? How do you?
What do you mean?
How do you make a good first impression?
I feel like you just got to be yourself, not be awkward. I feel like I'm big on like humor. I need someone to make me laugh. Like I'm all about chemistry because I couldn't be with someone who's boring.
None of that boring.
Like
shit.
Even though I love to fight for the room, but you know, we'll see.
I feel like you like yeah.
Don't shut up. You like ask me one question, and I'm like, and then in 14th of July, blah, 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 I'm like going on about something completely different.
It obviously took a lot. Like you got knocked down, got back up, got knocked down, get back up. Like, do those routines help you stabilize every single day, or is it what makes you stabilize?
I mean, like, look, I feel like it's you're not always in a good headspace, and I think I'm the kind of person that if I'm not happy, I'll make changes. So, yep. Like, you know, I was dating a guy, we broke up. Start of 2020, I was so unhappy in this relationship. We were living together. He was just like super like into drinking and everything and like just wasn't supportive of me.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I made the call to end it and step away from it. And then like, you know, then I made the move to change jobs, come down the coast. And like, that's been, I feel like how happy I am now as opposed to where I was like January 2020, like polar opposites. Cause like, come down here. I'm surrounding myself with awesome people. I've got a whole new group of girlfriends, and yeah. So it's a hard one to say. I feel like I definitely try and push it a lot on my socials. Like I try and do a lot about like body positivity and loving yourself, and you know how to get through hard times and everything. So yeah, I think if you don't make changes, you're never going to get there.
So important. Like so many of the like you go on Instagram, like as talked about, it's a highlight reel.
Yeah.
And there is lots of people like yourself doing hard, like doing work in that space and educating people and showing that life isn't all, it's all not pot of gold at the end of the rainbow.
Absolutely.
Like all the time. Because that's literally what it's been for the longest period of time.
I know.
So I love all that kind of stuff. Like it makes me happy. I've got a daughter that's 3 years old. So knowing that that kind of, that change is coming.
Oh, totally. I feel like good. Even from when I was growing up, like just the change in like female empowerment, feminism, like just everything around that space and like women being more confident and outspoken and all of those things. Like I feel like I can say things that I wouldn't have 5 years ago that I would now. And if anything, I get a way more positive reaction because of it.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
I think workplaces, like we're obviously our icon is a guy, Mr. Consistent. It's a white male.
Yeah.
Clearly. But our workplace is 70%, probably 75% female based. My wife is our GM.
Yeah.
Like we are, it's all about that. Like it used to be, I've worked in places like Billabong and other places where it's really male dominant. Mm. Like I know the place you work now is pretty female.
Yeah, totally.
Orientated.
Totally.
And, like you guys are like amazing. Like we've got useless nipples. Like,
like that's what do you guys do?
Yeah, literally. Like that's when my wife's like, what can you do with your nipples? Yeah. Like, can you grow a person?
Fucking like, classic.
Females are amazing.
Yeah, like, totally.
I love it.
Yeah. I just feel like there's been a big shift with everything. And I just want to be the person to like help promote that and like bring women confidence in all aspects of life. So whether or not that's like dating and like how to go on a date, how to, you know, literally I did a podcast the other day about like how to be confident in a bedroom. So like, you know, things to do sexually to make yourself, you know, feel better or, you know, insecurities, all of those sorts of things. So I think I'm just probably expressing things that I didn't get when I was younger and trying to push that onto younger people.
It's been suppressed for so long.
Totally.
Right? Like, not like, back in the day, you'd never put a podcast or a YouTube video out or something like.
No.
You had to be female, had to be confident in the bedroom.
Yeah.
Like it would never happen.
I know.
And you'd get absolutely trolled and bullied and.
Yeah.
Does that sort of thing still happen? Like, do you still no trolls anymore?
No trolls anymore. No, that's like it was so bad for so long, and now it's like I just feel like people have seen the other side to my personality, and they're just like really jumping on board with that. And if anything, people like. Love my weirdness.
Was there a point where you're like you're still getting me like, all right, I'm just like I'm not even gonna read this shit anymore? Like,
I couldn't read it. No, I wouldn't read any of it because you just like you couldn't. Like I had to turn my comments off.
Yeah.
Like I wouldn't check my DMs because like, it'd be like I'd have like 2,000 DMs all of abuse and like on your photos. Like no one wants to read that. That's not good for anyone's mental health. And it's like You know, it was so hard as well because I didn't get support from the other girls from the show either. Like a lot of them just shut off and went with the storyline and kind of like
just played with it.
Yeah, and like dealt with them being in the limelight. Like none of them reached out to me. And I'm like, well, if you really were a good person and I was a bitch, you know, even if I didn't like you, I'd still fucking check in.
Yeah.
So
you're actively dating now? You're out and about just doing your thing?
I've been like super I've been super boring late. I mean, I guess that's such a lie. I went to Sydney for a sexcapade on the weekend. But I feel like
borders are open.
Yeah, borders are open. I'm coming for you. I'm not really like looking for anything too serious right now. I feel like I'm just
Tom. I'm joking.
Hey, yeah, young.
You're like, that's me. No, I feel like, I mean, obviously, like, I do want to end up meeting someone, but I'm not going to settle for anyone unless I actually see a future there. And yep. I'm, like, so happy being single, doing my own thing that I'm not going to waste my time.
Yep.
So I'm definitely, like, actively going on dates and doing things. And you do, I mean, you do it to hope that you might meet the right person, but at the same time, I don't know where I'm going to be in 5 years or – you know, I don't know if I'll always down the Gold Coast. It's just the world.
Let it play out.
Literally. So I'm 27. Like I've got so much time.
Got any like real good cringy dating, like just first dates or date stories?
Oh, I have so many. I'm like, where do I even begin? I like started like going on the dates with this guy off, I think it was Bumble or something. And we like went on this first date and it was really good. Like he was a legend. Went to Canvas and Wallace. And then like he walked me back to mine and I like grabbed his shirt and I was like made out with him. I was like, chat to you soon. Anyway, next minute this guy's obsessed with me and he is like texting me nonstop. Like he was like a uni student. I'm working full time. And I'm like, I can't
support you, brother.
I can't text you all day. Yeah. And then he just kept doing like weird stingy things. So we were like going to go to Top Golf and he's like, I've just looked and like the booth prices is like, it's quite expensive per hour. You know, maybe we should go with a bigger group to split it up. I was like, dude, you don't have to pay for me. Like I just, you know, it was like $20 each or something. Anyway. And I was like, don't worry. Like, let's just do something else. Let's go to dinner. And I was like, he came over to mine. I was like, what about like Justin Lane? He's like, looks really busy. Yeah, no, gets worse. And so he like kept kind of like, I kept suggesting restaurants and I felt like he didn't want to go to them. He's like, why don't we just go to the Sushi Train? And I was like, okay, fine, go to the Sushi Train by Coles. This is like literally if you want to get murdered, go there. It's like
– at Miami there?
You know, the one at Miami Coles. Yeah, Miami. Yeah, it's just terrifying. Anyway, so we went there. I was like not really vibing. And then we like came to the end and like I literally had like two plates and he had like I don't know how many heaps. And he was like, do you want to just split it? And I was like – I'll just fucking pay for all of it. Like, are you joking? It was just awkward. So like that was really shit. I've had some bad ghosting.
Really?
Yeah, dude. This is kind of a fucked up story, but I'm gonna tell it anyway.
Give it to us.
I was seeing this dude. We were like super obsessed with each other. I was like moving to Bali. He threw me a going away party with like 200 people at his house. We were like on. It was so much fun. Anyway, then I moved over. He came over to see me. We had like the best romantic weekend. Then on the Saturday night, he's like, it's my friend's 30th. Like, let's go to Uluwatu. I was like, all right. Anyway,
Single Fin, here we come.
Yes, literally went to Single Fin. They were being like embarrassing drunk people. And then he's like, I'm going to scooter back. And I was like, dude, you like, I've been scootering us all weekend. You cannot even drive. Like, don't be an idiot. He was like trying to get on a scooter with no helmet, forced a helmet on him. I don't know why I did this, but I like got on the back. Anyway, we're like, you know, Uluwatu has like, if anyone who doesn't know, it's like in the hills of Bali and
it's very high up, very steep, very slippery, very dangerous.
No lights. Like it is the roads are not lit.
Pitch black.
But yeah. It's terrifying. Anyway, so we start driving. I'm like going around this corner and then like we start going really quick. I'm like, fucking slow down. Like, what are you doing? He's like, the brakes aren't working. I was like, dude, what the fuck? Like, anyway, we're going around this corner. He like flipped the scooter. I flew off. He like just kind of went in the shrubs. And then I was like, fuck, like I need to go to the hospital, like blah, blah, blah. He was like, no, like let's just go back to the house and like keep partying. Like, you'll be fine. Like, I'll take you there in the morning. I'm like, red flag. Anyway, so we go back there. I'm like literally covered in like blood and like all this, like I'm like in so much pain. And then he like wants to keep partying with them. We eventually go back to the hotel and he's like, I'll take you there in the morning. So then we go to the hospital on the way back and I have to get x-rays. I've like fractured my ribs, like my tailbone, like all this shit. And then I ended up, like, my dad was like, I'm getting you back to Australia. So flew me back to Australia and he flew back as well, like the day before me. Yeah. Got home, didn't offer to get me from the airport, didn't send me flowers. I was like bedridden for a month and he just like didn't visit me, didn't see me at all. Went radio silent.
What a dog.
And like met my family and everything. Like they fully knew him. I was just like, that's like the worst of the worst. Like you cannot get any more ghosty dick than that.
Bad person.
How bad is that?
That is just bad.
I know,
person.
I know. And I told, I
his
told.
His mum should fucking spank him.
Literally, how poor bad form person. Is that? I told this like, on they another didn't podcast. Spank him enough. And he like reached out to the girls and was like, hey, like, I just don't want you to think I'm a shit bloke. I'm like, well, like, I just, it's like, I hate these men that
you did it.
Do these fucked up things and then like are embarrassed when they're spoken about. It's like, no, if you do something fucked up, like, people should speak about that. Like,
stand
that's
up,
not
own
okay.
It. Yeah.
Literally, if you do something shit, then like deal with it.
What's your perfect date then? Because you've had the bottom of the barrel by the sounds.
Literally, what is my perfect date?
We were talking about ramen off air and you love ramen.
I
maybe
love
it's ramen.
No, I feel like a perfect date.
Ramen with candles.
I've had, like, I mean, like, look, when I lived in Bali, like, it's like you drive out to like a beautiful beach and, you know, go for a swim, get coconuts, hook up, like, I feel like that was always really nice.
Yeah, yeah.
That was super good. I don't know. Then
I was going to choose this card. Applied for a TV show.
Oh, really?
That's in here. I will put that one over here because
we already know the answer to that. I think probably like my best sex experience was I was like on a secluded beach, like skinny dipping with a boyfriend. I'll get in trouble if I send my ex. You can like shuck oysters there and we were like shucking oysters and like I fucking love oysters and like feeding them to each other and then next minute we're like in the shore and I'm on top of him. We're having this like epic sex out in the open on the beach, like the water coming in, eating oysters. I was like, fucking here, here. Like,
perfect date.
Yeah, literally perfect date done. Yeah, that was awesome.
All right. I've got a couple here because I've answered a couple of these in other potties. So I'm gonna pick out a couple here that I haven't answered.
All right, done.
All right. If you haven't, the aim of the game is never have I ever. It's coming out and like hopefully it should be out by the time this podcast is out, but if not, it will be out in the next few weeks. But it's basically a bunch of never have I ever questions. And the rules are the person who shakes the slowest cocktail goes first. That's you. Conveniently.
So convenient. Yeah, yeah.
So you get to choose a card. If you haven't done it, if you don't have a story, just throw the card away. But if you have done it, tell a story. And if I've done it, then I have to tell a story.
Okay.
And then Kirsten and Tom sitting over here will – you're supposed to play it in a group setting. So whoever's done the – whoever's got the weirdest or like craziest story wins a card.
Okay, done.
And move on. So
done.
Choose a card.
Never have I ever been an extra in a movie. I haven't.
You haven't?
I mean, like, I've been on TV, but.
No movies. Chuck it away. New card.
Okay.
No story.
No story on that one.
Two.
Oh, shit.
Choose the best one.
Choose the best one.
I've definitely re-gifted something I didn't like. That's a given. Or, like, just that you have no purpose for it. But I feel like it wouldn't be a good story to be like a candle or something.
Yeah,
I'm like,
nothing.
I need this glasshouse candle? Yeah. No. Happy birthday. Created a fake social media account for stalking purposes. Ooh. I mean, like I have a few social media accounts for other things that I would use to stalk.
Yeah.
So yes.
Yeah, but nothing specific for stalking.
Oh, it might be like, what is my friend's ex-boyfriend's girlfriend doing?
Right.
And she's not going to know if I watch the story from my account. So I'd do that and like maybe do a screen record or something. Crazy girl shit.
All right. That's not a good enough one. I need you to choose something else. I need some crazy shit.
Yeah, you do. Give me some better questions. Right. Okay, never have I ever moved overseas for a relationship. I've moved overseas to get away from a relationship. Does that count?
Not really.
Okay.
So give it a pile.
Give it a pile. Let's go through. I feel like this one's in your wheelhouse.
Never have I ever had a paranormal experience. That's like with like supernatural things.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Really?
So I'm
first person.
Really?
I've asked this question to so many people and everyone's like, nah. And I'm like, I don't get it.
I mean, I am really into, like, I'm like quite into the whole like psychic stuff. Like I'll go and get my tarots done.
Or, Ouija boards and shit?
I used to do Ouija boards when I was a kid, like really fucked up. Like I'd go to my best friend's house and there'd be four of us and we'd like do it in her downstairs room. And she lived in this like mansion that was creepy as fuck. And like lights would flicker, all sorts of crazy shit. And then I like legit convinced myself that I'd like let out a ghost that was following me. But I've had some like pretty weird, I'm going to sound like a lunatic if I say this, but I'm going to say it anyway. So like I used to see this lady who was like quite spiritual and she'd teach me a lot about like kind of connecting with like your guides or spirits or stuff.
Yeah,
so
right,
she
yeah.
was like, you need to ask for signs. Like if you ask for signs and things happen, like you'll know someone's there to help you kind of
How
thing.
How do you ask for a sign?
So, okay, for instance, I like wanted to break up with my ex and I was like, okay, if I should break up with my boyfriend, I want to see a pelican. Like I was like, what the fuck? Like I'll just think of something so random that I never see. I shit you not. The next day I'm scrolling through Marketplace. Someone's selling a painting of a pelican. Then I'm drive. And then he like went on a bender all weekend, didn't call me. And I like entered it and I'm driving home the next day. And I shit you not. There's this like lake thing. And there is a backyard with like 30 pelicans in it, two pelican statues. And I'm in the back car with my friends and I'm like, are they fucking pelicans? They're like, yeah, why? I was like, holy shit. And then I just could not stop seeing pelicans. So I felt like it was the universe trying to tell me that I was like on the right path.
Did you drive past this pelican farm every day?
Never seen it in my life. Like never seen it. So I feel like that kind of stuff, it's like, using that like higher power to like help you and guide you in life.
Yeah.
But yeah, I've definitely like had some freaky ghost shit. That was probably a shit story. Freaky. Partied with a celebrity. Oh my God. I've got a really fucking good story for you here. You're going to die. This is one you're going to want to put in. Okay. So I used to work in like nightclubs when I was a teenager. And
what nightclub specifically? We're talking about
Overload and Bola Bar.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I Park remember. Life, like 2010 or 11. So I was like running all the like artist liaison, like marketing yep. shit or whatever. Anyway, so they hosted the before party with all of the artists and the after party.
Yeah.
And Friday night I'm there and I'm like just kind of like giving them drinks and chatting to everyone. And I had, this is like kind of weird because he's kind of gross, but I hooked up with Armin van Hilt.
Stop it.
The story gets juicier. So you know the guy that's my, oh.
He's a lord.
He was literally head to toe in matching Louis Vuitton. And then I had like all these weird messages in my phone being like, hey, Kat, it's Armand. Why don't you come to my hotel room? And like we'd all just listen to my friends and I'm my like Nokia. Anyway, so then the next night we're like partying again. This is actually a fucking good story. And Diplo starts DJing. So he's best. DJing for the club. I'm behind the booth. I end up fucking crowd surfing. Weird, don't do it. And then he's
hands
like-
Hands going everywhere.
I'm like, whoa. Anyway, he's like, come back to the hotel room with me. Like, come back to the hotel room.
Who's this Diplo?
Diplo. And I was like, oh, okay. I was like, I think I was, this is gonna fuck, I think I was 17. Anyway, so I like get in a cab with him and- Crystal Fighters and then like two other people I knew and we go back to this hotel room. He takes us up to this like cleaning level and he's like, everyone follow me. I'm like, oh God, what are we doing? There's like this little like box with like all these towels stacked up in front of it and he pulls these towels to the side and there's this tiny little hole and he's like, everyone crawl through. I'm like, okay, this is where I fucking die. So like, anyway, that's when I then decided to crawl through the hole. So then I crawl through this hole. I get out the other side and we're like in the spa and pool area. And they're all like, everyone, let's go skinny dipping. And I'm like, fuck, this is so hectic. But I'm like, YOLO. So I'm going skinny dipping with Diplo and Crystal Fighters. And it's like 6 a.m. in the morning. And then he's like, let's go back up to my room, like blah, blah, blah. So I like got up to, I actually didn't sleep with him because I didn't really know a lot about sex and thought I'd get AIDS if I slept with this famous teacher. Okay, I was like so young. Anyway, so we were like hooking up in his bed and he's like, come to Sydney with me, like come to Sydney. I was like, okay. Like he's like, come to the festival again. So he books me flights to Sydney and I then catch a cab home, pack an overnight bag, go to the airport, pick up a friend on the way and fly to Sydney, like kicking on. And then I got there and I completely freaked out. I was like, oh my God, I'm going to get AIDS from Diplo. And didn't go and see him. And I still regret it to this day. I'm like, because we were like texting a few years ago to meet up in Bali. But yeah, so that was definitely like my wildest story, like partying with him.
He's the coolest.
He's a legend. Mother. He's a fucking legend. So
he's very cool.
Like, that was so fun. But like, yeah, then I had to call mum the next day and I'm like, hey mum, can you please transfer me some money? I'm in Sydney. And she's like, what the fuck are you doing? So yeah, so that was like a bit of a high and a bit of a low.
One-way flight.
It was return. Hooked us up. But yeah, goodness. How funny is that?
That's so loose.
It was pretty loose.
I remember those days. That was around the time when me and Tom were DJing. But yeah. That's when shit like that could actually happen.
Mm-hmm.
Literally, yeah. That kind of shit could
happen. I'd sleep with Diplo.
Yeah. I know, he had a small dick, though.
All right, mate. All right, mate.
Yeah. I mean, like, I look back at it now and I'm like, please, like, who was I kidding? I have a good one about this, too.
What's that one?
So the next one is never have I ever gone through. Oh, wait, do you need to answer this?
What's that one?
The party with a celebrity.
Yeah, I can't.
You can't,
yeah,
okay.
Yeah, you win that
boring.
One.
Never have I ever gone through my partner's phone without them knowing. Okay. Yes, I feel like if you haven't, you're a liar. I feel like everyone's done this at some point in their life. Let's be real. Everyone look around the room. You've all done it.
100%. I caught my wife. I did it the other night because I was like, I walked in the bathroom. My wife was like, what? And I was like, what are you doing? She's like, none of your business. And then I went to it and she was like buying cryptocurrency, but she'd lost it. She's texting a friend of mine. She's like, I can't find my crypto. Like, he's been helping her buy it and stuff. And she's like, I can't find it, blah, blah, blah. Don't tell Jared. It was like $200 or something.
Classic.
Anyway, I was like, yeah.
That's so funny. So I actually went through my ex-boyfriend's phone and found out he'd kind of been cheating on me. So he would always delete his messages. And he got really drunk because he was legit an alcoholic, got so drunk, passed out on the couch. And I just had like, my gut was just telling me something. And I was like, I have to fucking look. Like, so I went through his phone. He'd been messaging this other girl that day down the coast, trying to sleep with her when he was dead sober. Meanwhile, he's texting me at the same time being like, hey babe, like just at work. And I was like, you're fucking kidding. I like got my phone, took photos of everything. And then the next morning I was like, so who's so-and-so? And he's like, I feel like I've saw a ghost. Like he's just went, what is it? What do you
paranormal
mean?
Paranormal experience. I know. Mm-hmm.
And then I found out that our entire relationship, he'd been going behind my back and like hanging out with this other girl. And he'd just been like lying and saying he was at the pub or still working and stuff. So yeah. So like, yes, I've done it. And I have done it before that too. But I feel like when your gut is telling you something, you're always onto it. You always know when something's up.
100%.
Whether it might be, you know, your partner buying cryptocurrency or fucking cheating on you. Like there's always something there. So no regrets. I feel like it's not a good thing to be in a relationship and not have trust.
If you pick up their phone and they're like, what are you doing? Or like, you know, when they act like that, something's in there that they don't want you to see.
And it's not just a birthday present.
We've had joint bank accounts since way before we married. I'm like, all right, I'm going to buy your birthday present. Don't look in the bank account. Blah, blah, blah. Like you're like, don't look for the next week until the payment goes through and you buy six other things or eight other things.
Yeah.
But yeah, you know, as soon as something's up and the phone flashes and they flip it over or whatever, you know, when you sit down dinner or whatever it is. Yeah. 100%.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Fuck, it's right there for you.
I know. So that's a good one. That's a good
one. What about this one? I was like, sexted the wrong person.
Oh, probably, or I probably sent like a sex photo or like a tit photo to like a girlfriend or something. They're like, what the fuck are you doing?
Who are you sending?
I've definitely texted the wrong person. Like, you know, when you go to say something about someone and then you text that person instead of that is like the worst. I'm so scared about it that if I'm ever talking about someone, which I just don't do because I'm like so nice, but like I'll always check my phone. Ooh, date just texted me.
Yeah, boy. What's good?
Cute. Smiley face. How was your day?
His ears are burning.
Yeah, literally. Literally.
How good. Kat, thank you so much for coming in. This has been awesome to chat to you. Learning about The Bachelor and shit, so funny because, like, I literally didn't think it was like that unreal show, but it sounds like it is. But really nice to learn things about you, your business, your self-care. The world is going in a really nice place, especially having a daughter, knowing that there's people like you out there doing, you know, all this body positivity work, all this self work, like just women in general.
Yeah. No, thank you. It's been so much fun. Definitely keen to come on again. So, no, thanks for having me.
We will definitely have you back. So you can, we'll see where you end up at the end of the month. You
might literally.
Hopefully you don't fall down the leaderboard too far.
Yeah, no. Well, I'll have to come back and get to the top.
Come back and get that podium position. Thank you so much.
Thanks, guys.
That's today's episode. I hope you enjoyed it. You know the drill. Like, subscribe, leave a review. Go show the Shake Up some love and stay connected. Don't forget you can watch all of our episodes on YouTube. Also, jump over to our Shake Up Cocktail Gang Facebook page where you can find out who's coming up on the podcast. And if you've got questions for them, I'll ask the bloody questions. You can also use the code SHAKEUP for 10% off on MrConsistent.com.au. Thank you so much for listening. And just remember, shit that's fresh.